When I was studying data science back in 2015, that's when I started. There was this story of an economist called Ollie Ashenfelter. So this economist, he said he could predict the price of the wine in an auction just by using data. And this was a very absurd idea back then. Data science wasn't a very hippie thing. So of course, it had to get some people mad, and that was Robert Parker, a leading wine expert back then. No disrespect to this guy. He was really great at what he did. But in his words, he felt that was a total sham, and he was predicting the quality of a wine much like a movie critic would predict the quality of a movie based on only the actors and the director. But then again, he did his mathematics and applied his predictive models. It was linear regression, by the way. So Parker said, the wine expert, that 1986 wine is going to be very good to sometimes exceptional. Okay, fair enough prediction. He understands wine well. So Ashenfelter had to counter it, of course, as far as this year. And he said, that's mediocre. 1989 will be the wine of the century, and 1990 will be even better. And of course, that happened. And it blew a lot of people's mind, and I felt, okay, this is kind of interesting. I'm a wine enthusiast, and of course, I love data science, so I thought I'll center my talk around that. Now, what Ashenfelter did was, he created a linear model, and he started predicting the prices. So I'm going to do something different today. Given that it's a novice level talk, I chose a data set that's fairly popular. In fact, it's one of the most popular data sets on the UCM machine learning repository. So if anyone wants to recreate this for maybe some similar beverage, or maybe you want to recreate this whole project, that is very easy to do. So my idea today is exploratory data analysis. So when I talk about data visualizations, we have two kinds of visualizations that we make. First is explanatory, which is the most popular kind of visualization, when we make a visualization to present something. That is something you would see in a newspaper, so that a general layman can understand this. But a data visualization goes from one data scientist to another. You could say it is a part of exploratory data analysis because that visualization was used to uncover some patterns. So building around this idea, let's just formalize what exploratory data analysis is. So once you have your data set, it's your first interaction with your data. So it's not a formal process. You have no rules. So you're not making any predictive models, and there's no hypothesis being formed. Fair enough. So of course, there has to be some set of techniques, but unfortunately, fortunately, there's none. Because it's a philosophy. How I might do it, it might be completely different from how you might prefer to do it. And see, that's how, there's no fixed rule how it should be carried out. So a very formal definition would be the practice of using visual and quantitative methods to understand a data set, importantly, without making any assumptions about its contents. So we would not say, I expect the mean to be this, so I'll just try to do my analysis so that the mean comes out to be that. That would be biasing. And to understand why I chose data visualization, let's look at this very classic example. So here are some data sets. So I've just colored them so that you can separate them out. The data is not important. What's important is when I do quantitative analysis, the mean, variance, mean of like both the variables, the correlation, regression line, and R square all turns out to be the same for all the four data sets. So either that means the data is same, it will exhibit similar behavior. But when I visualize that, I find, okay, there is some difference. So clearly visualization can help me uncover patterns as well, apart from reporting the findings to someone else. Starting with my main content for the talk, like what's in a good red wine. I chose red wine because it's more popular. You can replicate the same exact experiment for white wine. Second reason being, I was not very satisfied with my work with the white wines. So I want to do more on that. And probably we can always collaborate after the talk is over. So the name does suggest PyData. So I'm expecting there would be a lot of Python enthusiasts here. And it kind of sometimes get religious when I say I did not use Python. I chose R for this project. And why R is because I wanted to use ggplot too. Now, it's not important about the tool. Why I chose ggplot is because of a few reasons. I felt it's a tool that is better for visualization, and it was my preference. You can replicate the same project using any other visualization library that is out there. ggplot2, the edge I find is it's based on the grammar of graphics. So what grammar of graphics is, let's say you have to recreate this very simple plot. In this plot, you see a scatter plot, a line plot, and you see there's some elements where the line is in blue color and the scatter plot is red. Now let's see if I want to make this line dotted, or if I want to maybe change the color of the dots. ggplots offer this very intuitive sort of syntax where it offers a layer by layer system to create graphics. So I can define my point graph here, I can define my line here, and I can just add them all to create this one plot. So even if I have to remove just the point, so I just have to remove this one argument and I'll still have my plot interact without dealing too much with the syntax. So this is one feature I absolutely love over ggplot2. I haven't found a very good alternative in Python that is good enough yet. But if there'd be one, I'll probably switch to that, or I'll just continue with ggplot2. So in my talk, I'll have a lot of visualizations like this one. Just to see, like, when I was creating plots, it's not important like what the syntax was, what's the syntactic sugar behind a plot. So with ggplot2, I'll tell you when I have to create something which has to be sent to some other person, much like code reproducibility. There has to be something called, let's say, visualization reproducibility. So I created a base for all my plots. So this base was defined as all my plots would have an outline of a black color and the fill would be something that is maroon, so that I could say these plots are for red wines and my white wine had an off-white color. Using this base, as I said, there would be layer by layer thing and I can add up different variables. So I added this base the base variable and added the histogram and all that I wanted to add in separate layers, and I ended up getting such plots. So just because I wanted to use the system, I had an ideology, this is what I'll be continuing in making all my plots. So this is all about syntax in my talk. Now we'll be focusing on the visualizations. Pay close attention to the visualizations as I explained what my findings were. So as I said, I took a data set from UCI machine learning repository, which was about physicochemical factors. So we will not be talking about the age of the wine. We would be talking about how much sugar was in it, how much acidity was in it, how many sulfates, and what the alcohol was like. So these are the kind of variables that it had. Now, since we are also measuring an artistic variable, so there had to be something that's accurate enough to measure quality. So the quality variable is an average of what three well-known wine experts rated the wines. So based on that, the quality, they say it's fairly accurate since it's a large, it had a fairly large number of wines, and that's how the whole data set was created. And it was a very clean data set, so I just wanted to try if I could uncover something. So how I prefer making my plots is I want to study each and every variable on its own. So I first start with univariate analysis. So when I do univariate analysis, I like to make this very fancy looking plot. Although it looks fancy, it gave me nothing. But what it did tell me was it gave me my first interesting attributes, which I want to study further. So since this had 16 factors, so I don't want to study all 16 one by one. So I just decided maybe I find the alcohol, of course, alcohol is important for wine. Maybe sulfates, or maybe if I don't find something else, I'll just see whatever I know intuitively about wine, these variables should be important, I'll just start inspecting those. So as I said, acidity is important. You do not want the wine to taste too sour, and if there's no acidity, you won't like the wine. So when I plotted fixed acidity, volatile acidity, and then I created a new variable, total acidity, and this is often a very common process when you are doing EDA. If you don't have a variable, you might just want to mix up two variables and create a third one. So you notice that there is a skew towards the left. So there are more values towards the left. That means acidity should generally be very low, or very few wines possess high acidity. So this gave me a good indication that, okay, what the standard range for acidity should be for a good wine, or maybe for what it's like for most wines. So I thought, okay, acidity is good, so I just marked this variable and I'll inspect it further again. I knew sulfates were important because I read somewhere that it keeps the wine fresh. So you do not want the wine to go bad. Sulfates is what prevents it from oxidizing, and so that the wine doesn't get smelly. So I even tried a log transformation, but I did not find anything interesting here. So, but I just still kept this variable just because of my intuitive understanding. And then again, quality is subjective, but when I plotted the quality for what the experts had rated, I found out no one rated it very poorly or very highly. So that's human nature. Since there were no values for 1, 1, 2 and 9 and 10, so I found this plot. Now again in this plot I see there are a lot of mediocre wines, and I wanted to find out what separates the best wines and from the bad ones. So I did this. I made pairs of these bars and created A, B, C category wines. Now this is important. Now I know what the good wines are. They're A category rated, the bad ones are C rated. B ones are way too many. So in most of the plots I'll ignore to plot them because they'll just cause overplotting and my plots would be hard to interpret. So by this point, I thought, I know enough about individual variables, maybe I should just see if they correlate well. So to start my bivariate analysis, that is dealing with two variables at a time, I made this correlation plot. It's customary for me to make it. Usually I would find something very interesting, but maybe it's because it's a very subjective thing to how quality would relate to something. I found nothing very interesting. So there are some few red spots, but that is acidity relating to acidity, some different kind of acidity again. So no single property appeared to correlate with quality. So acidity versus quality. So I like box plots here. The reason I chose box plot was because it would amalgamate all the variables in one single box per category of wine. So the box plot did show me that the total acidity decreases as the quality of wines improve. So wines should not be very sour when you're tasting them. And you can also see that the best wines have their peak well below 0.4. So how do I show this in this plot? It's hard to interpret. But you'll get the idea, because I know where the most of the values are per quality. I can see the median line, they'll all lie below 0.4. Yeah, there were variables in the data. So I did not create any new variable apart from total acidity, because where I added the volatile and the fixed acidity of the wines. So the best wines had a peak well below 0.4. I apologize for not writing the units, because I forgot the units. I did not want to confuse everyone with the technical jargons if it's decimeter cube or something. So now that I was just finding, how do I build up on my findings? So sometimes I tend to break the rules. I said, since I was doing bivariate analysis, I can maybe add another variable and make a more interesting plot, so that I don't forget later that I found this from the box plots. So this is a kernel density plot. What it basically does is, so just focus on the, let's say, wines that were rated 8. So you can see for the wines that were rated 8 had a very low acidity. So that's around 0.4. And that had the maximum density in the whole data set. The density being maximum frequent, the frequent times that they were, like how frequent they were occurring in the data set. So that's a very good way to study when you study the frequency of a particular variable in a particular category. So that's what kernel density plots really help you with. Again, I broke the rules here. It's three variables: quality, volatile, acidity, and then of course I'm measuring the density, but I kind of like doing that at times. So of course, what separates grape juice from wine is alcohol, and low quality wines do tend to have lower alcohol, as I could see from the density plot here. But all this was very counterintuitive, because when I see this plot, I see the quality is increasing fairly linearly as alcohol percentage increases, which is not very intuitive. You won't see a wine with 40% alcohol, it would be very undrinkable. So sometimes that can happen, and that's I think the fun part of EDA, or maybe the frustrating part, that when you'll end up making lots of plots that will give you no information, or either would be misleading. So now that I know that I was being misled, so I tried a lot of plots. It turned out that making a linear plot was a good way to understand where I went wrong. So here we can clearly see that it increases up to 13% for red wines, and the 13% is the peak. So maybe that's a good shopping guide for next time you buy wine. And after 13%, the quality starts to decrease. So that's how sometimes you might have to change the plot. Your intuition might not work. I tried a lot of plots before just coming to this one. So that's one finding I did find in the bivariate analysis, apart from the acidity concentrations. So I still knew that sulfates was really important. So here I still started finding some nice plots, some more information than what I found in the univariate analysis. So good wines did have higher sulfate values than bad wines, but still I did not have any clear indicator. I tried removing the outliers and then plotting again, still no luck. But I could deduce that the sulfate value should be higher for the good quality wines. There are very few wines here, so I did not really look into that. So did everyone follow this plot? I was a bit fast here. Right. Now, I had good findings in my bivariate analysis part. The univariate gave me good ideas how to proceed with my bivariate analysis. So multivariate, I thought I'll just confirm what I found. Probably I was again misled. So just to confirm, if I wasn't misled, I should be good with these very simple plots. So if I were to plot the B quality wines, there would have been too many dots. So B category wines haven't been plotted here. So most C category wines that are marked in red have a volatile acidity of more than 0.8. So they are in this bad quality region. And then again, you see most A-rated wines have a citric acid value from 0.25 to 0.5. This is this good region. So see, without training a classifier, I have a you can say it's a rough decision boundary. So you can easily say if the volatile acidity is more than 0.6, probably this wine is way too sour and I should not buy it. So so without creating a predictive model, I could find a good decision boundary to make my decision. So again, I wanted to confirm sulfates. Sulfate was a weak finding in my previous analysis. So here you can very clearly see all the good wines max out till 1.0, whatever the unit was. But they do tend to have higher sulfate values than the bad quality wines. So that's somewhere around 0.6. So 0.6 to 1, if the sulfate level is, the wines are good. Rest are probably not good enough. So this just gave me a good idea. Okay, sulfate was important and I was right. And if, in fact, I should have probably put a vertical line here. So you can see after 13%, the wine quality does get really good. So even that can be confirmed from this plot. But then again, there should always be caveats. No study is perfect. Wine is very subjective. So when I showed the study to the people who are as fond of wine as I am, so they said, what about rose wines? This is not going to work with that. Or maybe if I'm getting a champagne, it's just sparkling wine, it's just carbonated. Your study might just fail there. And I agree. A lot of times what happens is, see, it could be my biasing or it could be the that I made the plots work the way I wanted them to be. And I could have probably fooled people with the early alcohol plot by saying, just increase the amount of alcohol and you'll end up creating a good wine. So this is always a caveat. And I agree the study is not perfect, but it does give me a good understanding if I have to proceed with, let's say, predictive modeling further, said about what variables are important, that and what are the variables that should go into the classifier. Since this talk is about EDA, I want you all to apply these ideas to your own projects as well. So what else can happen during an exploratory data analysis process? Outlier removal is one. So this is from a different data set. This blue dot was an outlier and it wasn't needed. I needed to find the red dots. So just if I remove this, how much does the plot change? Without changing the scales deliberately. All this is happening by default, the scaling. So how I did this was, here I understand that I want to remove this blue dot. So I just tend to find this attribute. So it is this attribute in the data with the maximum arg. So argmax would give me the maximum variance in that. And when I'll find that value, I'll just drop it from the data set. One warning, this won't work with when work with data sets where you have too many values. Because when you start plotting them, there's a chance that you might find a whole cluster of outliers over here. So there are better outlier removal techniques, but if you have less smaller data set, I find this technique really helpful because here it was a very highly imbalanced data set and I wanted to find the red dots more. Apart from that, okay, I did say, okay, it does not, I said there are no rules. So one of the rules I like to make for myself is I sometimes cluster the data set to find initial context. So one idea is that, let's say you have a data set of consisting of cars and you want to, before plotting, what you would want is, you want to cluster the similar cars together. You don't want to say this is a good car because of its mileage and it turns out it was a Ferrari. That's how clustering can help you find that initial context. Of course, identifying patterns. So before making your predictive models, it won't always work if you even get the best model in the world and you end up giving it sub-quality data. Or maybe you won't end up finding the best fit. So when I plot something like this, my immediate intuition turns out to be that I should plot a linear regression graph. So I probably do not need deep learning over here. And sometimes you might find something like this. So here I can understand, okay, so this is these are very large values. So what can bring large values closer together? It's a log transform. So I do a large log transform and then it's fairly intuitive that, okay, then I can probably plot a linear line or do something else with it. And you can always combine the both the ideas. So here I have an exponential growth. So when there's an exponential thing, you can again take a log and then you get a straight line fit. So you can combine these both these ideas again. So why you should not skip EDA? I think the ideas are fairly clear, but sometimes when you skip EDA, you can end up doing a lot of shallow work. Shallow in the sense you should not jump to conclusions and start developing predictive models right from the start. It's really important to understand the data set. One of the best approaches is just load it in an Excel sheet maybe, or maybe just load your data frame or view the data frame, like what the data is like. Try to understand what the variables are about. I read about wines, I understood what acidity is, I understood like what is the alcohol should be like, or what sulfates are for, it's for keeping the wine fresh. So once you do that, you'll have a very good understanding before creating a predictive model and you'll be better able to decide what is the algorithm that you want to use further. And okay, so now that we're coming to an end, I talk a lot about wine, too many students over here as well. It's a caveat, celebrate responsibly. Thank you.